Everyone, you made it. You're here. It's almost time for today's show. And before we get started, I want to invite you to let us know from where you're joining in the chat. You can also send us your questions, comments, and our guest author, Bijal, will respond to as many as those as she can. And teachers, parents, everybody watching, have your cameras handy because today we'll get a chance to take a selfie with our special guest. All right, let's now meet Bijal and solve the mystery behind Help! Why Aai Wants to Eat Me. Let the countdown begin.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Hello, and welcome to today's Flip event. I'm Kamalpreet from Team Flip, and we can't wait for today's adventure. Let's see who's there with us today. It looks like we have learners joining us from Bangalore, Mumbai, Noida, Palestine, UK. Wow! Welcome, everyone. All right, now it's time. Let's get to meet Bijal. Bijal, over to you.
Thank you so much, Kamal, and thank you, Microsoft Flip, for having me. And good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you all are tuning in from. Thank you so much for joining me and my book today. As Kamal said, I'm Bijal Vachharajani. I'm a children's book author, and this is one of the books I have written. It's called Help, My Aai, which means mother. Help, my mother wants to eat me. So, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the book, and then we're going to read a little bit, and I'm going to have lots of questions for you. So put them in the chat box and tell me your answers as we go along. Firstly, this book is about a boy. His name is Avi, and it's about his mother, who he calls Aai. He calls his father Baba. So this is about a whole family, and lots of things happen in them. This book is wonderfully illustrated by Priya Kurian, and you will see some of the illustrations there. So now, before I start, I'm going to tell you what's happening a little bit. Avi is in school today, and he's having a really, really bad day. Firstly, he had terrible food in his lunchbox. As you can see here, he's looking extremely unhappy about this. And secondly, he got punished in his mathematics class, and he had to stand outside, and now he's back in class, but his knees are really aching and he's tired. But suddenly, he remembers something and he cheers up. And I'll tell you what he remembers. First, I want you to tell me in your chat box, what is your absolutely favorite food to eat? I love chocolates, but I love mangoes. I love my mother's aloo parathas, which are these potato parathas that she makes. What about you all? What do you all love? Please tell me, and I'd love to know first. So while you all are telling me this, let me tell you that Avi absolutely loves cheese sandwiches. He loves thepla rolls. And more than all of that, more than pizza, more than chocolate, more than all of that, he loves his environmental science class. And now it's time for environmental science class. So he cheers up and he's sitting in the classroom. And he's even more excited because today is EBS Film Day, which means they all get to watch a wildlife film instead of studying. Isn't that amazing? So now he sits down next to AJ, who's one of his best friends ever. And he's saying, oh, my knees are aching. How am I going to play cricket today? And AJ is like, really, it's that bad? Shh, Shama hissed like a snake and glared at the two boys. Do you want to spend another class outside? Avi wanted to say something, but Shamana, she was the class monitor, and she could easily report him, and then he would have to miss Environmental Film Day. So far, they'd seen films, let's see, about climate change, about this tigress. Her name is Machli, and Machli means fish in Hindi. And she was called that because she had fish-like markings by her eyes. And she had seen a film about ghost crabs. And if you haven't seen ghost crabs, it's because they're so well hidden on the sand that that's why they're called ghost crabs. And so just then, Miss Mankar, who is their EVS teacher, walks into class. Now, every time Avi looked at his favorite teacher, he was reminded of a meerkat. See, this is Miss Mankar, and doesn't she look like a meerkat? Just look at her. And just so you know, that's Avi and his best friend AJ, and you can see Shama right at the back. And so like meerkats, Miss Mankar has an upright spine, broad head, and large bright eyes. Except meerkats are really tiny. She's 6 feet 1 inch tall, and clearly she was a very good teacher because AJ, as you can see in this, loves environmental science. So now it's time for the film. Miss Mankar shuts off the light. And what is the film about? It's about bears. Avi watched open mouth as, you know, bear cubs, they look like little candies, like little black candies. So he's watching open mouth as these bear cubs are wrestling on the screen. A mama sloth bear battles with a tiger. Now, who do you think would win? Because sloth bears are very cool. They're very fierce mothers. And when sloth bears have babies, they put them on the back of their on their back, and they walk. And just a second, I'm trying to find comments in this. So I'm saying that she keeps them on the back, and so this mama bear with her bear cubs on the back was walking, and suddenly a tiger came in front of them. Now, you'd always wonder that the tiger would win, but you forget that mothers are very, very fierce. And so the sloth bear mama and the tiger have a face-off, and the sloth bear mama wins, and the tiger has to go running away. And then something horrible happened. Something terrible, horrible, disgusting, huge, even worse than the day Avi was having. Another mama bear ate up her second born cub. At first, Avi thought she was licking the bear cub. You know how animals lick their young. But no, she just gobbled the cub up. Whoop, slurp, the baby was gone back in her tummy where she had lived for so long. Avi's eyes widened. Can you see how scared he is looking? He's really, really worried here. Avi's eyes widened. He gripped his pencil box tightly. What just happened? Did she really? No, that could not have happened. He squinted in the dark to look at his classmates' expressions. He couldn't make out much, but was Shama also looking horrified, or did she just look like that all the time? So now the rest of the film, Avi is not noticing, because all he can think about is the bear cub becoming breakfast for his mom. Or was it lunch? He was not sure about that. At long last, the film gets over and Miss Mankar switches on the lights, and before she can say anything, all the hands go up and, "Ma'am, why do bears eat their cubs? Could she not get any other food? But. Avi felt like he was in this other world, a world where mothers and fathers gobbled up their children, and there was no escaping that terrible, horrible fate. Miss Mankar, she's not worried because she's very wise. She laughed. As you can see, she's laughing. Have you ever seen a meerkat laughing? No? This is your chance to see one. Miss Mankar laughed and shook her head, and she said, "This is normal in the natural world. Animal parents know sometimes they don't have enough resources to take care of their children. So if, say, the baby is sick or weak, then the carnivore eats them because it leaves them more time to take care of their other babies. Sometimes it gives the mother nutrition because she's just had babies and she needs some nutrition. So she eats the runt of the litter, as they are called. Sometimes it's the other way around, where the young ones kill their parents. At other times, they kill the siblings. Oh, even males will kill off cubs in the pack to establish their dominance and show the who's boss. This was a sight to the natural world that class 2B had never, ever seen. So far, they had seen wrestling leopard cubs, cocoons turning into pretty butterflies, not bear cubs being gobbled up by mama bears. So now Avi is really worried, as you saw. So he asked Mankarman, ma'am, who all do it? Let me see, Mankarman said. Lions, because, you know, carnivores. And of course, as you saw, bears. Wild dogs. Then tiger salamanders will eat their peers. That's cannibalism for you, eating the flesh of your own species. She realized everyone's looking really shocked. And she's like, don't worry. It mostly happens in the zoo because they're very stressed. And just then the class bell rang and everyone leaves the room, and except for Avi, who's sitting in the dark, his ginormous headache has now reached big, unfriendly, giant bug proportions. But just then his friend AJ comes and reminds him that it was time for cricket. Bro, Avi forgot all about cup-chomping bears, bug headaches and tired knees, and ran off to the playground. Gone. There are no cons to cricket, are there? Of course not. Now, if you think that that was the end of what was happening, you are very, very mistaken. So, we're going to turn to the evening, to the chapter called I'm a Champion. All right? And what's happening is that Avi's family is sitting down to dinner. Now, here. So, that's Avi. You can see Avi at the bottom of the page, and then you can see his father at the one side of the table. His mother, Aai, is sitting right there, and there's Anjal, his very, very, very tall sister. Now, their father, they're all talking about something, and Avi was really angry. Remember, I told you that he had very bad food in his lunch. He didn't like the food in his lunchbox, so he was very hungry. And he was setting the table first. And there's this Indian vegetable. It's called bindi, which is also lady's finger, okra. And he doesn't like it at all. So what he does is he keeps it very far from his plate so it doesn't come close to him. Because every time he sees it, now he thinks they're slimy green fingers. So he's sitting and having a papad while his father is going on talking about some insurance work that has to be done. You know, have you noticed this adult world sounds like it's full of papers and things that need to be triple copied and signed. Multiple calls have to be made and everything seems to need Aadhaar card and PAN card, not Peter Pan, some PAN card. And lots of passport size photos. Just then, Avi's mother says, Avi, you haven't taken bindi? I did. He crosses his fingers under the table and beams. He had taken lots of dal, which he really liked. Aai frowned and she gives him some on his plate and says, eat, it's good for you. Anjal's sister starts laughing because she loves bindi. And then, you know, he's trying to distract them and he says, do you know, Aai? Mama bears eat up their young. Everyone at the dinner table turned to stare at Avi. Aai, Baba, Anjal. It felt like even the bindi was staring at him. Yuck, said Anjal. That's gross. You know, she used that word for everything. Everything is gross. Avi was gross. The bathroom was gross after he left it. His spewing of fats such as 2,368 bacterial species lived in belly buttons was gross. Now, Daddy says, that's not proper dinner time to conversation. Let's talk, not talk about this. But just then, Aai leans over to Avi and whispers, I would love to gobble you up, my cub. Chomp, chomp, you're so cute. I'll totally eat you up. She turned back to her food, still smiling. To Avi, her face morphed into the way cartoon hyenas cackle just before tearing into the carcasses in front of them. Worse, Baba roared with laughter. Anchal licked her lips as if they were all part of a cackle of hyenas with Aai as their leader. After all, females are always the leader in the hyena society. Aai no longer felt hungry. So that was a little glimpse of my book, Help! My Aai Wants to Eat Me. And Kamal, let's get you back on and let's see how hungry you are for more stories.
I sure am. That's actually made me kind of hungry. Okay, bhindi, but then the thought of bhindi staring back at me, oh my gosh, that's scary. I can't imagine my food staring at me. We're seeing so many amazing questions coming in through the chat, and we will get to those in just a moment. But before we do that, let's take a selfie with Bijal. Everybody out there, get your cameras ready and gather in front of the screens in your classroom or at home or wherever it is that you're watching us from. And we'll give you a few seconds to get set up.
This is difficult, taking selfies.
The children absolutely love it. And it is so interesting hearing from your book. So ready? Let's take some selfies. 3, 2, and 1. Thanks again for being here, Bijal. I hope everyone out there is having a good time and learning a lot. We'd love to see your selfies, so do post them out on Twitter by tagging us at Microsoft Flip at Bijal, that is Bijal_V. And now to your questions. The first question that we have is, how can someone become an author? So we've got people who are asking us, how can they become an author?
You know, that's a great question. And firstly, I'm very glad you want to become an author, because I think books are magic. And if you become an author, you become a magician. One of the best ways to become an author is to read other people. So you've got to read all sorts of books. Read fantastic books, read books you love, read books you don't like, read books that bore you, read books that make you laugh, read books that make you cry. Once you read, you start understanding how people write, what are their styles. And then the other thing is that writing is a muscle. You know how if you want to stay fit, you've got to keep exercising. If you want to write well, you've got to write regularly. Keep a journal. Write to your friends and family, write about what's happening around you. You need to be a good observer. And then you bring all of that together to become an author. So it's a lot of work and it's a lot of procrastination, which basically means that half the times I'm thinking about writing and I'm not writing. Instead, I'm baking chocolate chip cookies. I am reading a book and I'm staring out at butterflies. That's how you become an author.
That sounds like lots of hard work. Okay, so everybody, maintain a journal, be observant to the world around you. Now, we have another interesting question. What inspired you to write books for children? What inspired you to write books for children?
You know, I can't think of writing for anybody else, because I think children are very cool. When I used to work in conservation, I used to work on tiger programs. I worked with a lot of animal rescue programs. And every time I would meet children who've done some amazing things, they've raised money for tiger conservation. They've spoken up against climate change. They've rescued animals. And they've spoken to this schools and families to stop plastic in their houses. And it made me realize, you know, something, children are pretty awesome. And that's really why I only want to write for children, because, you know, you're an audience I'd love to talk to, I love to listen to, and which is why I write for you all. Because as I said, the adult world is full of paperwork. It's instead totally preferred talking to children through my books.
So yes, children out there, you guys are actually the change. Do good out there, go out there, do good, take action. The change starts with you. Now we have a question coming in from the SDG Warriors, who are saying that we really want to know, what was your inspiration behind writing Help My Eye Wants to Eat Me?
Hi SDG Warriors, love what you all do. Well, you know, Help My Eye Wants to Eat Me happened because my editor, her name is Smith Zaveri, and she used to work with Penguin at that point of time, had messaged me on WhatsApp saying, you know how animals eat their young? And I was like, yes, I do know that. I worked in wildlife. I do know that fact. And she's like, what if a boy thinks that's going to happen to him? I was like, what? You okay, sure, good for the boy to think that. And she said, no, you write the story. And I thought it was such a weird idea at that point of time that I just disappeared. I stopped talking. And it almost took a year for me to sit and say, it would be interesting, because you know how adults often, when they see cute children or babies, they're always like, oh my God, you're so cute, I want to eat you up. And from there, I started thinking that there is a connection between animals and people. So, and that's how Help My Eye Wants to Eat Me actually got written. It got written through a lot of WhatsApp conversations and through all my interactions with the wildlife world.
So great tip out there, okay, that we need to be observant. You never know from where you're going to be inspired. The next question is from Miss Archana. She's asking, please suggest some more tips for narrating story, as your way of expressing each incident is so very amazing. We were curious, and what will happen now?
Thank you, Archana, for saying that. Really appreciate it. You know, I must admit that I have always been very shy, so to be out there and talk like this has been hard for me. But you know, from one of the things that I strongly believe is that when you're narrating a story, you practice a lot. You read aloud a lot, because when you read aloud, you see how it's formed, how the words are tripping across from your tongue. Are they sitting well for you? Sometimes I pause and I just talk instead of just reading from the story, because sometimes I want to hear what children are thinking, what they want to react to the story. So lots of pauses, lots of listening to the audience, because you know you're doing this for the audience. And lastly, practice. And I think the last thing is that you need to love what you're reading and narrating, because otherwise it will show.
Great tip out there. Practice makes perfect. So then moving on, okay, thank you. Actually, thank you so much for your time and for inspiring us. Bijal, thank you for being there with us. But before you leave, okay, I have one more question for you. Which is your all-time favorite children's book on the environment, and why do you like it?
Oh, that is so difficult. That is such a difficult question. It's like putting a box of chocolates in front of me and saying, which one would you want to have? And I want to say all of them. And I think I should get to have all of them. So I'm going to give you two answers, because this answer changes all the time. Firstly, I love Ranjit Lal's writing. He's an Indian author who writes the best stories about wildlife. If you haven't, please read his Tigers of Tamil Valley. You will laugh and laugh with the story of this alpha tiger who's stuck taking care of his cubs. And in the wild, male tigers don't take care of the cubs. It's the tigresses who do that. And the second book that I really recommend is Robert McFarlane and Jackie Morris's Lost Words. They are actually poems that are spells that conjure up the nature world back into our lives. And if you can, and if you I'm sure you've already done this, get together, read them out loud, and get nature back into your life, because I think words are one way of doing it and images are another way of doing that.
Well, that's got me excited. Okay, I'm surely going to put that in my reading list. Okay, there's just one question which is coming in. Okay, it's come from the SDGs, SDG Warriors. Which is your favorite book and why?
I think I kind of answered that. To elaborate why, I'll tell you about Ranjit Lal's book, actually. Ranjit Lal's book actually is based on an actual male tiger who was observed taking care of his cubs. And there are these really clever Easter eggs in the book. There are these vultures called Diclo and Phaniac, which is actually the name of the pesticide that endangered their population in parts of India. And there's a poacher, of course. There's a National Geographic photographer who's out there in the forest. And there are these killer porcupines with their quills. So, it's just so funny. And I think humor is a great tool for me, for anyone to talk about wildlife. Because if you look outside your window, you're going to find lots of humor. Yes. When it's, you know, birds flocking to each other, sparrows. There's a lot of humor out there. We just have to keep looking for it.
That's a great thought. Okay, that just open your eyes, observe the nature which is around you. Love that thought. And thank you. Thank you so much, Bijal, for your time today and for inspiring all of us. That was amazing. And now, all of you watching us today, Bijal has put together a flip topic that you can use with your students right now after this event, or assign it to your class as homework. Head off to https://aka.ms/eatme. Yes, that's right. You heard that? Eat me. All right. Even though we are wrapping up for today, we have flip events every week. Head off to aka.ms/flip events to find an adventure that sparks your curiosity. That's it for today. I'm your host, Kamal Preet, and on behalf of Team Flip and our amazing guest, Bijal, thank you so much for spending your time with us. We'll see you next time. Bye-bye.